Sunday Night Prime. I'm Father Andrew Apostoli, a member of the Franciscan Friars of the Renewal. I'm delighted to be your host for tonight's program, which is a very special program. I'm sure you're going to find out an awful lot about some of the beautiful spiritual tradition of our church. But before we get into our program, I'd like to remind you, if you have any questions or comments, suggestions, please send your emails to us at sundaynightprime@ewtn.com. Let me repeat that, sundaynightprime@ewtn.com. You know, I did receive an email from someone named Nicholas. And Nicholas made this suggestion: Father, can you please do a program on the value of third orders? I believe third orders are a forgotten treasure in the Catholic Church and are essential to the new evangelization. Well, Nicholas, I have to say, I agree with you 100%. Third orders are very important. And we're going to learn about third orders today, at least one of them. When I first got this email request, I started to think, well, how can we put like the Carmelite Third Order and the Franciscan Third Order and the Dominican Third Order all on the same program? Well, that would have meant doing something like musical chairs, but that would have been not a very good thing to do. So I said, why don't we do a separate program on the different Third Orders? And that's what we'll do today. And we're going to start off with a wonderful Third Order, the Carmelite Third Order. In fact, our program tonight is entitled Carmelite Tradition for the Laity. And we're privileged to have two Carmelite Third Order members with us. We have Ken Cavalli, who is a regional coordinator, and we also have Edith Matlock, who is a regional formation coordinator. Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Father.
Welcome.
A pleasure.
Thank you, Father.
It's wonderful to have you.
Thank you very much.
You know, you represent such a very important and traditionally very spiritually rich tradition of the Carmelite order. And you have many great saints, you know,
Yes. People
who teach us to pray. And I know that's very special to you as Third Order members.
Definitely.
So it's my privilege to be welcoming you. Ken, how about, you are the regional coordinator. Maybe we could just say a little word about that before we get,
Sure. As regional coordinator, we are the link between the local communities and the lay Carmelite office. Each of our provinces are divided into regions. My region covers New York City and part of New Jersey, and I have 12 communities. And basically a troubleshooter who helps these communities adapt to situations, deal with any crises that come up, help them through the formation process, all that stuff. And there's a team of two people that do that for each region.
Oh, very good. Very good. And now, Edith, you're the regional formation coordinator. And what would be your work?
Yes, thank you, Father. And I'm the formation coordinator for Long Island. That would be Region 3. And I'm in charge of or oversee 7 communities. And what we do is we evaluate and help them in their studies and in their ongoing formation. Each community meets and has ongoing study in the Carmelite spirituality.
Very good. I know, I'm a religious, and I know we have Third Order, Franciscan Third Order, so to hear, your work, I know it's so important, Maybe we could start off with the question then, so our viewers could really understand what we're saying.
Mm-hmm.
What is a Third Order?
You want to take that one? A Third Order is a group of lay people who wish to follow in the spirituality of a particular religious order, in our case, the Carmelite Order. And these people feel attracted to the spirituality, and those who want to make a more firm commitment to that spirituality would consider joining a Third Order. We actually take vows, we make promises to live that way of life as a lay person following the spirituality of the Carmelite Order.
Mm-hmm. So you really have as a Third Order member, access to the rich line is kind of like a river of spirituality flowing through the Carmelite order over the years,
Yes.
And so we need Third Orders. Like that Nicholas said in his email, I believe Third Orders are a forgotten treasure in Catholic Church today, and I certainly agree.
And so also, Father, I think it's a way for lay people to become more involved in our Catholic faith and to also deepen their own spirituality if they have a particular calling towards a particular spirituality, like Ken and I did with the Carmelite Third Order. But it is a way for the laity then to become more deeply involved in our wonderful Catholic faith.
Yes. You know, I was telling you before the program, one of the things that used to upset me so much in the 80s, the 70s and 80s, a lot of our young people leaving the Catholic Church because they were saying, well, we want to find out about mysticism, we want to find out about contemplation, and so they were becoming Buddhists, so they were going this religion, that, you know, usually some Eastern mystery religion and
exactly.
so on. And here we have, especially the Carmelite tradition, we have the most
some
beautiful...
Masters of contemplation.
Contemplation,
yes.
Mysticism,
yes.
The whole thing.
Exactly.
You can't get any further advanced than, I don't think, St. Teresa
of Avila. Right. Exactly.
And John of the Cross, a great mystic.
Oh, yes.
Also, yes.
Yes. Yes, St. John of the Cross talked about those dark nights.
Yes.
And, I mean, like no one else, I mean, they, see, I think it's so important for the people who are viewing this. You know, if you're looking to want to learn more about our faith and the rich sources that we have for things like prayer, contemplation, even apostolic types of work,
yes.
find out about the Third Orders. Find
yes.
out about the Carmelites, and you'll find
definitely.
That might be something there that really attracts you for your life.
Yes.
You know, we could say the same thing of the Franciscans and Dominicans
right.
and so on. Well, you know, tell us something about maybe the origin. I know we talked about this a little bit before the program, about the origin of the Carmelites.
Well, it's interesting that the Carmelites, the original Carmelites on Mount Carmel during the period of the Crusades, were lay people for the majority. They were people who had come for the Crusades, and many of them decided to stay there. A long tradition of spirituality on Mount Carmel, particularly stemming back to the prophet Elijah.
Yes.
And many people stayed there at his well in the spirit of contemplation, in the spirit of prayerfulness, and they became hermits. But the actual affiliation of lay people to the Third Order didn't come until about the middle of the 1400s, when the Pope gave us permission to first to create the Second Order with the nuns, and also to bring in lay people to the order. The real heyday of the lay Carmelites Third Orders would have been like in the 1700s, the 17th century, the mid-1600s. And from then it has changed and grown. But I mean, that's it. There's been a lay tradition in the Carmelite family throughout our history.
Mm-hmm. So that's wonderful, you know, because people who are in the world, they may be married people, they may
yes.
be people who have responsibilities that they could not become priests in the First Order. We should explain, too, that the Third Order means there is a First Order. That's usually the priests, the religious,
exactly.
yeah, priests and brothers, mm-hmm. you know. And then the Second Order would be the contemplative, cloistered
nuns
and
yes.
so on.
Exactly.
And Third Order could then be either religious. There are I know we have a lot of Third Order Franciscan sisters
mm. exactly.
and Carmelite sisters, different
yes.
groups. The Carmelites are the aged and infirm.
Yes. Exactly.
You know, and then the at the same time there are the laity, mm-hmm. and these are people who really want to share in the church's deep spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a great, you've got a great history there, you know. And
yes.
What about your own personal experiences now? This is how did each of you come to become acquainted with the Third Order? What was your little journey, your story?
Well, for me personally, I was I had left the church for a lot of years and came back to my faith. And about 11 years ago, and under the tutelage of a very wonderful priest, Father Andy, who has since passed away, but while I was studying with him and relearning my faith, he said to me one day, Edith, he said, please find a spirituality because you're making me crazy. Because when you first are on fire with the faith, you tend to go all over. You
yeah.
know, I was going to prayer groups and retreats and on and on, and then someone gave me a book called Springs of Carmel. And I read the book, and I just felt the calling that this was for me. And it was an introduction into the Carmelite way of life. And that happened 8 years ago. and I went through the Carmelite formation program. Mm-hmm. And it's really a period of discernment for at least 3 years, and before I made my final profession. And so I've been a practicing lay Carmelite now for about 8 mm-hmm. years, I think, mm-hmm. but professed 2 years, mm-hmm. final professed.
Mm-hmm. Wow, yes. that's really great. Yes. Very, very good. And I'm sure your life is so much richer and happier. Huh?
And so much different, yes.
So much different, yes. Maybe we'll come back and talk about some of those differences, right. because those are the challenges.
Yes.
Definitely.
You know?
Yeah.
Yes.
But Ken, how about yourself?
Mine is a very different path. I grew up in an Italian-American parish in Brooklyn dedicated to Our Lady of Mount Carmel, and there was a lay Carmelite community, although it wasn't a Carmelite church. And I joined the Third Order when I was 16 years old, so I've been a Carmelite member for 37 years.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And it was actually much more like a confraternity in the early days, but the formation wasn't as grounded as we have it now. And over that period of time, we've seen tremendous changes in the lay Carmelites. And now our formation program is so much more intense and so much more fulfilling in that we learn so much about our faith and about the Carmelite history, the Carmelite saints. So it's been an interesting 37 years.
Wonderful, wonderful. And isn't it true, you know, two things. When you study like the order, the development, some of the saints, I mean, as I said, you have magnificent saints. You sort of get drawn into, it's like almost getting to know these people. The communion
yes.
of saints, right?
Yes.
We have the communion.
Exactly.
We have the communion.
Yes.
You know, this is one thing that many of our separated brothers and sisters don't appreciate, okay. but which is so beautiful in the Catholic Church. You know, the saints become our friends.
Yeah.
You know, you pray, everybody has their own favorites, you know, and
of
you
course.
Pray to them, and they're like you're such good friends to you, you know. And the second, the other thing, too, is that when you go through, historically, something happens. It's one thing about Catholicism. We have a historical faith. We can trace back 2,000 years to Jesus,
yes.
you know, in the early centuries, and then the Middle Ages, and then mm-hmm. the more beginning of modern times, right up to the present. We can trace something. It's a living tradition, and the order becomes a living tradition.
And, yes.
and even seeing our Carmelite saints from the different stages mm-hmm. of the church, including modern saints. We have saints from the 20th and 21st century.
Right.
So it's an amazing ability yeah. for us to see how the spirituality changes, but still stays constant.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. So you, I'm sure, would want to tell everybody that they should run out and become Carmelite Third Order members.
Yes, yes.
You know?
Well, to be brutally honest, it's very important to help people discern if
yes.
the Carmelite spirituality is the one
yeah.
that they're directed for.
Yes.
Some of the most challenging things for us, because each of the communities just loves to have new members, but sometimes
sure.
you have to tell them that maybe your spirituality isn't tied into what.
That's true.
Yes.
That's true.
That
yes.
discernment process is a challenge,
yes.
particularly for us in the positions like we have, helping the communities to try to find a place for a person. Maybe they belong with the Dominicans or the Franciscans.
Yes.
We just help them
yes.
to discern where they need to be.
That's right.
There
is something different. We call that the charism. It's a kind of spirit that starts to develop, and it's almost identifiable.
Yes.
Now, every age adds something
yes.
To that. For example, you know, you had the community of the monks, but they were religious, who would take the place of some of the Christians who were captured by the Muslims,
yes.
you know, and their name slips my mind right now, but I'm sure they're not doing that now.
Exactly.
But they're probably doing something to win souls for Christ in a
mm-hmm.
different way.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
And
we adapt to the times.
Yes.
We read
yes.
the signs
yes.
of the times.
We read the signs
yes.
of the needs of the church.
Exactly.
And it's the Holy Spirit, you know, who keeps producing, raising up these new communities to meet the needs of that church at that moment.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, to again help people to move more deeply into their relationship to God.
And
absolutely.
And throughout absolutely. It, our basic charisms stay the same. We're committed to prayer, to community, and to service.
Right.
Those
right.
are the three charisms yes. of the Carmelites.
Yes. Very, very important. Well, you know what? We're going to be taking a break in a few moments here, but we're going to be coming right back, and we're going to learn an awful lot more about this wonderful Carmelite spirituality for the laity. So don't go away. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Sunday Night Prime. I'm Father Andrew Apostoli, your host for this program today. And our program is entitled Carmelite Tradition for the Laity. We're very happy to have as our guests Ken Cavalli, Regional Coordinator, and Edith Matlock, Regional Formation Coordinator. Well, you know, we've been talking about the order. You know, now, what happens when someone joins? I know there's you mentioned the formation, mm-hmm. and it's even the ongoing formation. Yes. I'm still an ongoing formation as a Franciscan.
For all of our
I always quote, Yogi Berra, it ain't over,
till it's over.
You know, right. when God calls us, then our formation is over. Right. Yeah, but tell us a little bit about what would happen now. Someone enters, what are the steps they go through?
Well, in the first, you know, if someone feels that they have a calling towards this, they would come and meet a community in their area of where they reside, and then they would attend a few of the community meetings and have dialogue with the different members of the community. And if they decide that they would like to be received into the order, we would start the process. They would begin formation first with a formation instructor for the first year, and then after the first year of discernment and they decide they want to continue, then they are actually received, what we call received into the order. The old term would be like a novice.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be received into the order, and they would receive
their ceremonial scapula
that we're wearing now. And then after that first year and they're received, they continue with another 2 years of formation with an instructor. And then they have their temporary professions, where mm-hmm. they do make temporary promises. And the whole time, though, that they're in formation, there's still a discernment period
right.
for them. And that's what the formation period is all about. At the same time that they're doing individual formation at their level, in the community, which meets monthly, they would be having ongoing formation as well in a broader sense.
That's right.
And then after they're temporarily professed, then they go on to another 3 years of study and then make final promises into the order. Mm-hmm. And then they become final professed.
Right.
At that point, there is no more individual study, but then it's ongoing formation in the whole community.
Right, right. Yeah, because you see, in the beginning, that's kind of like the military has their boot camp, and you learn the basics
right.
and all. Right. You know, you have to have that basic training.
Right.
And then
yes.
What is expected of you living the life. And, of course, you mentioned, Edith, about the word discernment, right? You mentioned
yes.
discernment here.
Yes.
And it's the individual has to come to that too, right? They have to
Absolutely.
Feel, am I being called to this? Is this helping me to grow closer to God? And
right.
Fulfill?
It's a twofold process. Both.
Yes, yeah.
The individual is discerning their call, and the community is discerning is this person being
yeah.
called?
Yeah, yeah. For some, for example, somebody may have a more obvious, call to something like the Dominicans, maybe, or the Franciscans, or, you know, even maybe to religious life as a cloistered
right.
person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so the third order gives them an opportunity to really help hear God talk to them.
Yes,
exactly.
You know? Exactly.
And, I know to grow in the spirit, huh? Now, what are some of the studies that they would do, let's say, when they're going through that first initial period? Would you I know you have the rule.
Yes.
Do you study that?
The initial yes. phase is really like an overview. It just mm-hmm. gives them an overview of everything. And we do start teaching them the rule. We did bring a copy of. It's called mm-hmm. Living the Carmelite Way. Mm-hmm. It is the latest version of our rule was promulgated in 2003.
Mm-hmm.
And they have an actual manual that they study. They have two-hour mm-hmm. classes every month, and also attend the regular community meeting. And once they've gone through the overview, that's when we start to discern whether there's an actual call. And if they feel there is, and the community feels that they have made progress, then we invite them to be received into the order, and that's when they receive the scapula. And then they set out on the more intense journey of formation for the next 2 years of 24 additional lessons. Mm-hmm. After that period, then we asked them, are they ready to make a more formal commitment to us? Yes. And we're studying the Carmelite saints, we're studying the spirituality, we are learning, and you talked about listening and hearing. One of our primary issues is silence and solitude. You That's right. can't hear the Lord unless you take the time to be silent and listen for Him. Right. And learning the practice of living in the presence of Almighty God.
Right.
That's what slows us down and brings us to the realization that there's something special that we're learning about. Mm-hmm. So learning that those two issues, being in the presence of God, silence and solitude, are really crucial in the formation period. Yeah.
I was just going to say, the Carmelite order were known to be the prayers of the church.
Right.
And part of our charism, a very important part, is to learn to be contemplative and to be, like Ken said, to be silence and to have quiet prayer time in our own lives. And this is all part of our formation that teaches us how to do that. And of course, we have the great saints that help us, of course, St. Teresa of Avila and St. Teresa of Lisieux. So.
Sure, yeah.
John of the Cross.
No, we don't want people to get scared off. We can never talk again.
No, not at all.
It's a kind
not
of.
One of the blessings is hearing the saints explain what prayer was all about. Like St. Teresa of Lisieux, the little flower, said that prayer, and particularly contemplation, is just gazing at the Lord. Mm-hmm, it's that simple. Yeah. And Teresa of Avila refers to it as a simple conversation. With a friend who you know loves you deeply.
Yes, yeah. Right. Isn't that so a beautiful description of prayer?
It takes out that you know, ooh, it's so far and pie in the sky kind of a feel about contemplation. It really isn't. I mean, it is a gift given by the Lord, and you grow into it, and it's a freely given gift. Not everybody will be in contemplation at all times, but knowing that the Lord just loves you and wants to give you all these special gifts, it's a beautiful blessing for us.
Yes, yes. Yeah, I just wanted to say that just in case people were getting a notion.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah, I think we put the idea of contemplation on a shelf somewhere that's so unattainable, and it really isn't.
No. But you need to withdraw from, you know, being bombarded with noise and confusion, contradictory messages from the world. You got to be able to shut that out, or you can never hear God talk to you.
Exactly.
Yes,
you
know, exactly.
And it's as simple as remembering that at every moment you're in His presence. Mm-hmm. Yes. And that suddenly brings it all to reality for you. Mm-hmm. It really does.
Mm-hmm. Well, you were mentioning, who was it, Saint Lawrence before the...
Saint Lawrence of the Resurrection.
Yeah. And
blessed, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. Blessed, okay. Yes. Yeah. Finding God among the
pots and pans. Yes. And Teresa of Avila used a similar expression about finding Him among the pots and pans as well. So it's an everyday life. We're looking, you don't have to do anything monumental.
Yeah. That's right.
To practice the spirituality.
Right. Yeah, I love that quote of the little flower, you know, she said, it doesn't take a long time to become a great saint. It just takes a lot of love.
Yes.
Exactly.
And, you know, we can learn to be living our daily life, offering everything we do, you know, to join it to the will of God and trying to accomplish what He sets before us each day.
Yes.
And, you know, with that union of our will with His, you know, and His living presence in it. That was one of the things I know I taught in the seminary for 27 years. And it was a survey course on Christian spirituality in the West. And one of the areas that the seminaries loved the most was going through the teaching of St. Teresa of Avila in the interior castle.
Yes.
And I always love to teach that. But she really explains how, you know, we need to bring virtue and prayer, you know, together to really accomplish what God wants us to do by doing His will.
Yes.
You know? Now, you mentioned the profession of promises. What are they? Could you explain it? People might mind, no, you're not making the same vows as the religious, but you're making parallel vows, promises.
They're patterned after the vows of the religious.
But they are patterned after the vows of the religious, but it's geared to our state of life as lay people.
Right.
And so we promise first to be obedient to our prior general in Rome, and also to the order of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. And then also to be obedient to the way of life of Carmel. And we promise to live that way of life according to our state. According to our state. So where the religious might take vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience, we make promises as best we can in our state to those very same things, to live a more simple life and also to live a chaste life according to our state in the lay world. And, of course, obedience to the teaching of the Catholic faith, to our order, to our rule, because, you know, the lay Carmelites do have the Carmelite way of life. And so those are the promises that we make at the different stages.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. And, you know, they're very, very helpful. You know, that's what these three knots on the cord represent, you know, it's for us as religious. So we always have them with us to remind us. I had a funny story years ago. I did a baptism, and I got, believe it or not, I got to the people's home before they got home with the baby. You know, now there was the home was open, and there was some neighbors were sitting on one side in the room, and I sat on a little single couch on the other side of the room there, and in walks this boy about 7 years old. Well, he's looking around and he sees me, and he comes right over to me, makes a beeline, you know, and he's looking at me, and you know, and he's talking in a normal tone of voice, different things, and all of a sudden he spots these knots, and he goes, what are those knots? So I didn't want to use the word vow because I knew a little boy would not understand what the word vow was.
Exactly.
So I said, well, I made God three promises. See, one, two, three. Well, his eyes got like five times bigger than they were. You know how they get mystified.
Yeah. Little kids, exactly.
You know? And so then he begins a conversation again about all different things. And, you know, I forgot about the knots, but he didn't. He comes back to, and he gets real secret again. He goes, how do you make those knots? And I figured the easiest thing to do was take one apart, right, and remake it for him.
Right.
As I started to take it apart, he steps back and he yells to the ladies on the other side of the room and he points at me and says, look at him, he's going to break his promise to God. He thought by just taking
the knot apart,
I was breaking my promise to God. But it's a good reminder, you know?
Yeah, excellent.
So,
yes.
But you know, isn't it true? You know, in your case, the promises, my case, the vows, they are, you know, just like wedding vows you make, wedding promises. And, you know, you keep them. They remind us of what our love is meant to be, you know? So I've committed myself to this. And that's the beautiful thing. It's free. You know, you have to be free to do it, and you have to do it out of love, you know?
Exactly.
So that's a wonderful thing. Now, I know, you know, as a result of that, you know, how then do you live then those promises in your daily life? How would you go about it? What, like, I know that you, don't you have something with the divine office and so on, mass?
Yes, we are. Yes. We are required to say morning and evening prayer on a daily basis as members of the Third Order of Lay Carmelites. We're encouraged to go to daily mass if that's practical for us. It's not mandatory. We're encouraged to spend some time daily in prayer, in contemplative prayer, in mental prayer, at least 15 or 20 minutes according to our schedule and our times. And sometimes it's difficult leading a busy life. It can happen. Now that I'm retired, it may become a little easier. But, you know, those are the thing we're challenged to do and to share our faith as much as possible in our community.
Oh, very good. Yes. So that really, you know what's nice about it? It kind of gives you a little structure that you have something. It's not all, I got 100% free time, I can do this, whenever I want. Then you end up doing nothing because it's not organized. It's just like the human structure way God made us. He gave us a skeleton so that, you know, we got flesh over that. Otherwise, we'd look like an amoeba if we didn't have a skeleton. Right?
Slinking around the woman.
And it does, it gives you a purpose also, and it's almost like living an intentional life. Where your intentions are to do certain things, and because of your promises, but also because of the love of Carmel and love of our Lord.
And you know, doesn't it happen too that the more you do it, the more you really fit into it, and it becomes really part of you and something you really look forward to wanting to live.
Yeah, absolutely.
The promises originally make it mandatory, so you feel like you're compelled to do it, but suddenly it becomes an enjoyable part of your life.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I miss not saying morning prayer in the event that something comes up and I'm, you know, stuck in a doctor's office and don't get out in time to say morning prayer. I still feel compelled to, I want to know what was going on. I want to see the continuation of the story, basically.
Yeah, fidelity comes over you, that feeling, you know, and you know, you want to be faithful because you've made a promise to the Lord, and that's something. You're a good example, you know, I think it encourages other people, you know, when they know you pray faithfully. Sometimes they'll use the excuse, well, I don't have the time. Well, you know what? You make the time when you believe in it, don't you?
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, we're going to have, talking about time, we're going to have to take a little break now, but we're going to be right back. We've got some wonderful things in our last part of our program. Welcome back to Sunday Night Prime. I'm Father Andrew Apostoli, your host for tonight's program. And we've been talking, our theme has been Carmelite Tradition for the Laity. And we're very happy to have as our guest, Ken Cavalli, Regional Coordinator, and Edith Matlock, a Regional Formation Coordinator. So we've been talking about the wonderful spirituality of Carmel and how living your daily life and what a person goes through, you know, information entering. I know you're wearing your scapular, and you refer to that as the ceremonial scapular.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Could you say a little bit about the scapular? I know a lot of people know something about, but I know there's a distinction between the scapular we're there, maybe a personal scapular that someone wears.
You want to take that one
off? Okay. Well, the ceremonial scapular, the Third Order Carmelites received upon their reception into the order.
Mm-hmm.
We are allowed to wear this basically on our feast days, when we're in community with Carmelites, at our retreats, but we're not allowed to wear it like in public. Like I couldn't wear this to work every day.
Mm-hmm.
The scapular that most people wear, and I also wear under my clothing, is the regular scapular of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. And that anybody could actually be enrolled in the Scapular Confraternity or the Scapular Society, and you become enrolled in it and you wear it.
And then you share in all the gifts of the Carmelite Order throughout the world.
Mm-hmm.
And also the promises of Our Lady.
She'll protect you.
Protection, yes.
And that's what it really means to us. It's an outward sign of Mary's protection. And for us as lay Carmelites, the ceremonial scapular reminds us of our promises.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And when we put on the scapular, we say a very simple prayer, use me this day. It's just like I said, it's a simple reminder that that's why we're here. We're, that part of service that we're called to is basically whatever the Lord wants us to do wherever we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not called to stand on street corners and preach. We're called to preach to those who we are given, you know, your family, your friends, your community.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those are sometimes the most important ones to deal with, aren't they?
And sometimes the most challenging.
yes, because it's sometimes easier to influence a stranger than people that you live with or you know very closely, because they know you. They take you very much for granted, I think.
Yeah. Well, you know, when Jesus returned to Nazareth, he didn't have a very great welcome.
That's right. He said prophets are not without honor except in their own home, indeed, and their own native place, and indeed their own home. I think that, again, many of our people would have, you know, known the smaller scapular, but it is a beautiful sign of Mary. And, you know, isn't it interesting, which I think is really a beautiful sign for the Carmelites, when the Blessed Mother appeared in her last apparition at Fatima, remember, she appeared three times.
Yes.
She appeared as, she revealed herself as Our Lady of the Rosary. Remember, the children had asked in the second apparition, which was the June apparition, they said to Our Lady, the people want to know who you are and they want a sign that you are truly coming here. And she said, in October, I will tell you who I am, and I'll give you the sign. Well, the sign, of course, was the miracle of the sun, which was magnificent, seen by an estimated 75,000 people. Mm-hmm. It's the only miracle that I know of that actually happened according to a date and a time, you know? Mm-hmm. So it was predicted well in advance. But the other thing was that the children saw Our Lady three times. You know, she came as Our Lady of the Joyful Mysteries with St. Joseph and the Christ Child blessing the world. And isn't it interesting now we're getting a little bit more emphasis on St. Joseph?
Yes.
You know, Pope has allowed us, Pope Francis has allowed us to insert the name of St. Joseph in the second, third, and fourth Eucharistic prayers. We were never there before.
Yes.
You know, the second time she came as Our Lady of Sorrows. Mm-hmm. And you remember, she came with Christ as a young man. Mm-hmm. I used to think originally he must have been Jesus in his passion because she's a Lady of Sorrows and he's a Man of Sorrows. Mm-hmm. But that's not true. He came as a young man. And many feel that that was a prophetic reference to what we call today the luminous mysteries.
Yeah.
Because it's Christ as a young man, right? His public life. But when she came the third time as the Lady of the Glorious Mysteries, remember, she came as Our Lady of Mount Carmel.
Mount Carmel, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think it had something, in my thinking anyway. Mm-hmm. I never asked her why she came, but it's very beautiful.
Yes. And,
but I thought, my thinking was that it was on Carmel, as you mentioned before, Ken, you mentioned, you know, Elijah, and his victory over the false prophets.
Yes.
Very powerful.
Yes.
And so Mary comes, I think, as Our Lady of Mount Carmel, because she has that promise to protect us and give us the crown and the palm of victory in Christ and protect us, especially at the end of our life.
Yes. Could there be a more appropriate image for the modern world that we're living in?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
False prophets seem to be abounding.
Oh, yes. 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 So we're going to expect great things then from the Carmelites, right? See? So you do have a mission, and I know you were referring to that mission, you know, as evangelization. Mm-hmm. Through holiness and prayer.
Yes.
You know?
One of the types of prayer, too, that the Carmelites promote is Lectio Divina.
Why don't you explain that? Yeah,
okay.
That's very important.
Lectio Divina is the meditation on the Word of God through Scripture reading. And so we sit quietly with Scripture, and we take a phrase or a section, and we read it over and over again and meditate on it and let it really enter into our hearts and form us. And so as lay Carmelites, we do this in our community meetings too. We take the time to do 15 or 20 minutes of Lectio Divina. And as individuals, we're encouraged to do this, you know, frequently in our own prayer life to develop the spirit, you know, the spirit of Lectio Divina in our own personal life. So that's part of a type of prayer. That's a beautiful, beautiful way in deepening your own prayer life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And reminding that Scripture really continues to speak to us even to this day. It's a sometime when you go to Mass on Sunday and you hear the same reading you've heard year after year or in the cycle, and then you're in a different place in your life. So that's the same image with Lectio Divina. Every time we read sacred scripture, it speaks to us at the point where we are in our lives at that moment. Mm-hmm. And Lectio Divina really gives us the opportunity to take the maybe three or four lines of scripture and say, what word is jumping out of the page to me today? What does that word mean to me? And the end of Lectio Divina is to take that scripture and then apply it to how am I going to improve my life today? What am I going to take from the scripture that's going to make me a better person and make me a better person for those around me?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it's really a beautiful prayer form for us.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You also mentioned the prayer as being our vocation. As a Carmelite order, we were very privileged to have Pope Benedict say to us that our mission is to teach the world to pray. And that was both a blessing and a beautiful thing to say, but it's also a challenge. It's a serious challenge for us to live up to that expectation.
Yes.
And we hope that we are at least trying to teach people to pray.
Mm-hmm. We're encouraging, you know, different, like through our days of recollection, This past Sunday, we had a beautiful day in celebration of the Feast of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, and we opened it to the general public, and we enrolled them into the Scapular Confraternity, and we encouraged them to stay and pray with us, which many of them did. So things of that nature is encouraged throughout the order to teach the public, of course, a wonderful prayer life.
And one of our young Carmelite friars, who's in formation himself, came to give us two talks during the day. And it was wonderful to see how he decided to speak about the Holy Spirit, and Holy Spirit with Mary and Elijah being our two models for the Carmelites. And he did a wonderful job. It was inspiring for us to see how new generations of new Carmelites are still learning the same traditions.
Yeah, very, very important that we hand on these beautiful treasures, the works of the great classics, St. John of the Cross and St. Teresa, as we mentioned, and of course the Little Flower, too.
Her book,
The Story of a Soul. I mean, really. You remember when she said that she told her sister to make sure that got printed right away, because she was convinced the devil would try to stop that. And I think within like 10 years, it was in 16 different languages. Isn't that amazing? Saint Pius X called her the greatest saint of modern times. Yeah. You know, it's an interesting fact that was probably little known, but I read this somewhere. But Padre Pio was seen in bilocation at both the beatification and canonization of Saint Therese of Lisieux. At both of them,
you know.
And, he really loved her.
He did. He never left the friary. By location, you end up back there. One who saw him, I think it was Don Guanello, who's either a blessed or saint now himself. He saw Padre Pio, and he was walking over to him, and Padre Pio went into the crowd. He disappeared. That's what happened. The bilocation ended, and he was gone. Yes. But that was the respect that and love that he had for the Little Flower, and she really taught us to have this great trust in God's mercy, and to really approach him with that childlike confidence, right? Her little spirituality,
simplicity.
And her message, I think, today of love, her message speaks to love, and that's so important in our world today. I think she's so important today to look to.
And of course, she stressed that sacrifice. Remember, she said, the food of real love is sacrifice. And she reminds us. Mm. And she made little tiny sacrifices. She didn't do anything awesome. I always think of that. It's almost like a contradiction, the fact that when she was dying, remember, and she heard those two nuns talking outside of her room, the window, they were outside, and she could hear them because she went in bed there, the window. And they were saying, when they died, they would send a little description of the life of the sister to the other Carmels to tell them who the sister was that died. Right. And they said, what are we going to write about her? She didn't do anything. She only became the greatest saint in modern times. So that is a message that we need to get out there, especially in view of this age where we have such a secularization. Take God out of everything. We need to really bring it and bring him back. Of course, prayer is the beginning. I remember, when they had the years ago, like in the 60s, crazy times there, God is dead. Remember they talked about that God is dead? Yeah. The best answer that I ever saw to that was on a bumper sticker and said, my God is alive and well. I just spoke to him this morning. so if you're praying, you not only know that God is alive, you're alive. So you have a great challenge there and to make people's hearts turn back to God.
Yes.
And prayer is a step,
That's the
first step. We begin to pray, we have hope.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
So, now I know you mentioned too, what would be, as you're drawing upon your own experiences with Carmel, things that you feel you would want to encourage others to maybe consider being like Carmelites. Maybe there's something that you could draw. I don't know if you have something in your own experience that meant so much to you, and how living your Carmelite life has enriched you and just brought a joy that you would not find somewhere else.
I think for me personally, one of the things that I found as I became more and more into Carmel was I didn't realize the depths of the order. There are so many paths in Carmel. Personally, I'm very interested in social justice, and we do have an NGO at the
United Nations.
At the United Nations, you know, the Carmelite Order does. And I was very surprised to learn that. I didn't even know that. And also, what it meant to me also in my own personal life is it gave me a deep, not only a deeper relationship with our Lord, but a deeper understanding of our Catholic faith. It really taught me all of the richness of our Catholic faith. You know, studying scripture more, studying the saints, studying the early fathers of the church. It has just led me down this wonderful path of enrichment in my own personal life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, of course, Saint, when you talked about the Catholic faith, remember the dying words of Saint Teresa of Avila, I am a daughter of the church, I die a daughter of the church.
Yes.
She was loyal, she was faithful. She is one of, I know, she's one, for me, one of my favorite saints. I really love Saint Teresa.
And, she loved the church. She loved the church, yes.
And yet, you know, she lived at a time when the Inquisition was studying her works. Remember that? She had to write the interior castle in almost like the third person.
Yes.
Well, she would talk about, well, I knew this nun who did this or said that. That was her.
Yes.
But she had to talk that way because they were so, you know, they were just keeping an eye with suspicion of, especially any woman mystic.
Yes.
I guess it kind of, you know, put up some red flags there, you know. Mm-hmm. Sad to say, but that's history.
And
you have to take it in the context of when it happened and why it happened and where it happened and so on, you know. But your mission then is to helping people to pray. And I know that's your own life. Do you join? Do you invite people to come to pray with you? Do you have days of recollection? And
Yes, we do.
Are they ever open to non-members?
Yes.
We quite often bring people who express interest in the community. So ask them to come to a day of recollection so they can get an understanding of what we're all about.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well,
one of the things that tends to draw people to the Carmelite Order is people who have an innate devotion to Our Lady in some capacity. And it's interesting, when they come to us, they usually end up with a very different understanding of who Our Lady is, because we talk about her as being our mother, but we also talk about her as being our sister. She's a companion with us on the journey. She's helping us to get to her son. She's helping us on the road to encountering her son, and usually by reflecting on her in the scriptures. What do they say about Mary? We don't hear much about Mary in the scripture, but the one thing we always hear is that she always listened and she pondered on everything in her heart.
That's right.
And that gives us a whole different understanding of who Mary is and her place in salvation history.
That's right. The importance of having Our Lady there, you know, I think it was St. Augustine who said, Mary was both the mother and the disciple of Jesus.
Yes.
And he went so far as to say it was actually more important for her to be the disciple of Jesus than the mother. That's almost so surprising that this great saint would say that. But what he meant to say, here I am trying to interpret the mind of this great saint, but what I understood him saying is she had to grow in faith, hope, and love as we do. And that's what we do in our discipleship.
Yes.
So she had to be that example.
Yes.
I think that's what you were saying, that we have to look to her. She has to relate to us. Or we have to relate to her. How we can serve her son.
Yes.
See? And so that's, you know, so very, very important for us to keep that in mind. There was one more point I wanted to bring up about, you're being a living witness to the Blessed Mother's approach, you know. You're very blessed by her, you know.
Yes.
She certainly, if anyone's going to draw us to Christ, it's going to be her. And she would remind us, you know, of in this particular time we're in, I you know, me with Fatima, I'm very yes. much involved with Our Lady, with Fatima. But we need to be able to be faithful to her son. And, you know, we without a foundation of prayer, you know, we can't do it. Mm-hmm. You can, you'll have a fit and a start, you know.
Exactly.
People will want to, but without a foundation for prayer, we would be like when the gospel which said that the seed that fell among the thorns and the weeds, and it started to grow, but it got choked off, and mm-hmm. because there was no, you know, the weeds and all choking off, or maybe
right.
the rocky ground, huh? There was no depth. Mm-hmm. So Carmel certainly does give you a depth, and we look to the Carmelite saints to inspire us. I think we all would like to feel we have the intercession of the Little Father.
The beautiful thing is that by learning about them, by studying their works, by learning about their lives, we take them off the pedestal. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We bring them down, and they make them human beings for us.
That's
they make
right.
them someone we can relate to.
Right, and that's important.
Exactly.
Right? Yes. Yes.
And when you talked about fits and starts, you know, in your prayer life especially, I always think of St. Teresa of Avila, who says, when that happens to you, and just persevere, and then when you stop, she'll say, well, do it anyway.
That's the quote I was looking for before.
Do it anyway.
Do it anyway, right. Well, on that note, we are going to have to end now.
Okay.
It's been a wonderful program.
Our pleasure.
And I hope that all of our viewers have been inspired. Maybe you never know. We might have some new Carmelite laity listening to this program.
That would be
thank
but let's
you,
end with prayer, okay? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, you have blessed your church with the whole Carmelite charism and spirituality. May many be encouraged to follow in this way. And we thank you for this gift to the church. And I bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Well, we come now to that part in the program where we make a little appeal to ask our viewers to help support the wonderful work of EWTN. You know, the program we've just had, we couldn't get this message out there, and perhaps we touched many, many people today to give them at least a desire to learn more about the message of Carmel and the saints. Especially their great writings. So without EWTN, we couldn't have touched all these people. So we ask you all, please pray for EWTN, and in any way that you can contribute, you know, be as generous as you can. I know God will reward you because you're upholding a great work of evangelization in the church today. Thank you, and God love you.